Electric aircraft concepts are everywhere these days, especially electric VTOLs, but what few are willing to admit is how impractical most of them are. The biggest hurdle is battery technology, with insufficient energy density usually resulting in poor range, which means most of these projects get absolutely nowhere. But one hybrid electric aircraft project recently caught my attention and got my brain juices properly flowing. It's called the Electra Ultra Short, and some of its design features are really impressive. It's a fixed-wing, short-haul aircraft designed to carry up to 9 passengers, and it's built for ultra-short takeoffs and landings. But what really stood out to me is how it manages that without sacrificing cruise speed. Let's get into it. The Electra Ultra Short is a fixed-wing aircraft with fixed-position motors, so it doesn't utilize thrust vectoring. Aside from its 8 electric motors, at first glance, it doesn't seem all that different from a conventional fixed-wing design. Electra is targeting the ability to carry 9 passengers with luggage or 3,000 pounds of cargo, that's 1,360 kilograms, with a range of 1,100 nautical miles plus a 45-minute reserve. With that kind of range, it's clear. This is no battery-only aircraft, but a hybrid. And in my opinion, hybrid projects like this have a far better shot at real-world commercial success than most of the pure electric VTOL concepts currently in development. To power its electric motors, the Electra Ultra Short uses a gas turbine in turbogenerator configuration. A turbogenerator is similar in core design to a turbojet, except its purpose isn't to produce thrust. Functionally, it's more like a turbo shaft engine, but instead of delivering mechanical power to a rotor or propeller, it drives a generator to produce electricity. The motors can get power directly from the turbo generator, from a few small onboard batteries, or both simultaneously for extra boost, particularly useful during short takeoffs. The batteries can also recharge in flight whenever excess power is available from the turbine. For this, Electra partnered with Safran to develop a 600 kilowatt turbo generator, which is equivalent to 815 horsepower. It's based on Safran's Arano turboshaft, a 1280 shaft horsepower engine that powers the Airbus helicopter's H160, which uses 2 of them. The variant to be used in the Electra is already in advanced testing, and while no official fuel burn numbers are published yet, Electra claims 40% lower fuel consumption compared to similar aircraft. Using the Arano specs as a reference, we can reasonably estimate a specific fuel consumption around 0.5 pounds per horsepower hour, perhaps even better. This would allow an efficient cruise in hybrid configuration. Electra hasn't released specs for the aircraft's 8 electric motors, but based on the 600 kilowatt total output, we can estimate each motor delivers between 70 and 100 kilowatt. Electra states a cruise speed of 175 knots true airspeed, which is quite respectable for a 9-passenger aircraft with short field performance. For comparison, the Cessna 208 Caravan, also a short field capable plane which carries a similar passenger load, cruises at 186 knots powered by a 675 shaft horsepower or 503 kilowatt Pratt & Whitney PT6A turboprop. However, the Caravan needs at least 1,000 feet or 300 meters to take off. The Electra is targeting just 150 feet. So let's take a closer look at how the Electra achieves that. The first design decision worth examining is Electra's use of 8 electric motors and propellers. Why not just one or maybe two? Using 8 propellers means each one must be relatively small in diameter to have sufficient clearance. This has some interesting implications. Propeller tip speed is limited due to compressibility effects. Once the tip approaches Mach 0.8, efficiency drops sharply. For any given RPM, longer blades produce higher tip speeds, so smaller propellers can spin faster before crossing that threshold. This might sound like an advantage, but it's not. At least not from an efficiency standpoint. Smaller diameter propellers must spin much faster to produce the same thrust as larger, slower spinning propellers. Faster spinning props accelerate air more quickly, which reduces propulsive efficiency. This is because the power required to accelerate air increases with the square of the airspeed change. Put simply, it requires less power to move a large volume of air slowly than a small volume quickly for the same amount of thrust. This concept can be illustrated by imagining the propeller as a flat disc, commonly referred to as actuator disc theory. A large, slow-spinning propeller is more efficient because it accelerates more air with less energy. There are other side effects. High-speed slipstream from small props increases aerodynamic drag over the airframe, which we'll circle back to later. So from a pure efficiency standpoint, fewer, large, slower spinning propellers are more efficient. But what about total thrust? In theory, 8 small propellers could produce more total thrust than 1 or 2 larger ones if their combined disc area is greater. But even in that unlikely scenario, it's only possible if the 8 smaller propellers have more power available. If the total power available is fixed, say 600 kilowatts, then spreading it across 8 smaller, less efficient props won't produce more net thrust than fewer, larger ones. So, why would Electra knowingly sacrifice efficiency by going for multiple small, fast spinning propellers? The answer is because it creates blown lift. Blown lift is additional lift generated by the high-speed propeller slipstream flowing over the wings. This energized airflow makes the aircraft less dependent on free stream air for lift, which is a major advantage during takeoff and landing. It allows the wing to generate more lift at lower airspeeds, meaning much shorter takeoff and landing distances. But this effect becomes really effective when combined with double-slotted Fowler flaps. When the flaps are lowered into that fast propeller slipstream, they become blown flaps. The high-speed airflow over the wing, including over the extended flaps, dramatically increases lift, especially at low speeds where normal airflow wouldn't be enough. With 8 propellers mounted on the wings, a large portion of the wing benefits from this blown lift. If Electra had used just 1 propeller on the nose of the plane, the blown lift effect would have been negligible. Even 2 wing-mounted propellers wouldn't have covered enough span to match what 8 can achieve. Of course, it's important to note that blown lift requires high-speed airflow, which is naturally produced by small, fast-spinning propellers, not by large, slow-turning ones. So while 8 small props are less efficient, they're critical for blown lift. This is exactly why the Ultra Short can take off in as little as 150 feet and fly as slowly as 35 knots, which is approaching super STOL competition territory. Not only that, you're entering helicopter territory. Sure, helicopters can take off and land vertically, but they're expensive to operate and create a lot of noise. The Electra will be much quieter and far more economical to operate. But what's equally impressive is its versatility. Despite being able to take off and land at extremely low speeds, it can still cruise up to 175 knots. That gives it an operating airspeed range of 140 knots. For comparison, the Cessna Caravan stalls at 61 knots and cruises at 186, giving it a range of 125 knots. So not only does Electra achieve remarkable low speed performance, it does so without sacrificing high-speed cruise. Earlier, I mentioned one of the downsides of small, fast-spinning propellers, which is that they accelerate air more aggressively, which not only lowers thrust efficiency, but also creates additional drag over the airframe. Since parasitic drag increases with the square of the airspeed, this fast-moving slipstream causes a lot more drag than large, slow-spinning propellers would, and this affects cruise efficiency. But the Electra cruises a very decent 175 knots, which is good for a medium-sized propeller-driven aircraft. Achieving that kind of speed with the available power and 8 fast-spinning props and all that slipstream drag should be nearly impossible unless something else is going on here. And there is. Electra's engineers clearly anticipated this issue. Instead of mounting the motors in streamlined nacelles along the wing's leading edge, they hung them below the wing on pylons. At first, this might seem counterproductive as pylons add more drag, but this design lowers the motors and propellers so that most of the slipstream flows beneath the wing during cruise, not over it. Hanging the motors from pylons is possible since electric motors are really lightweight. You might think, wouldn't the wing still be in the path of that slipstream? But when viewing from the front, only a small portion of the slipstream hits the wing. The majority flows underneath, where it creates less drag. Okay, wait. Didn't I say earlier that blown lift works by energizing airflow over the wing? And now I'm saying that slipstream mostly misses the wing in cruise. It sounds contradictory, but it isn't. Here's why. Blown lift is only needed during slow flight, like takeoff and landing. In that phase, the Fowler flaps are extended, and even though most of the slipstream still passes beneath the wing, it flows over the flaps. Some of that fast slipstream does go over the wing and helps delay flow separation, but together with the airflow going over the flaps, this dramatically boosts lift at low speeds. Then, once in cruise, the flaps retract, and the majority of the slipstream goes under the wing and no longer creates significant drag, allowing a cleaner aerodynamic profile. So I guess you can have your cake and eat it too. Now, of course, the pylons do increase drag compared to sleek nacelles, but this is mitigated by reducing slipstream drag with the low-mounted motors, and any remaining drag penalty is outweighed by the benefits of high lift performance at slow speed. From a reliability standpoint, having 8 electric motors doesn't really offer much advantage, as electric motors are already extremely reliable, even more so than the turbo generator itself. But distributed propulsion does open the door to other potential benefits. One interesting possibility is improved control authority with differential thrust. For example, the outermost motors could be used to assist your control by increasing power on one side and reducing it on the other. Now, I don't know if Electra actually plans to use it this way, but if they do, it could reduce the size and weight of the vertical stabilizer, since the rudder wouldn't have to do all the work. Of course, for certification, the aircraft would still need adequate rudder authority in a full power loss scenario, so the benefit here might be limited. Another clear advantage is in-flight power distribution. With 8 electric motors, you could potentially shut some of them down during cruise to reduce drag and save energy. For example, instead of running all 8 motors at 75% power, it might be more efficient to run 6 motors at full power and shut 2 off completely. The total power consumed is similar, but you've reduced drag by stopping 2 propellers from spinning, since a spinning prop, even when not producing thrust, creates substantial drag. This wouldn't be possible with just 1 or 2 motors, and even with 4, shutting down 1 introduces a yaw imbalance. But with 8 motors, you could shut down 2 or even 4 without affecting balance or stability. Of course, this assumes the aircraft uses variable pitch propellers that can be feathered to minimize drag when shut down. If the props are fixed pitch, the motors would need some form of mechanical brake to stop the propeller from windmilling. Otherwise, they'd continue to generate a lot of drag as they spin. There is also a more speculative possibility, which is using windmilling propellers for regenerative battery charging, like a wind turbine. While technically possible, it's highly unlikely to be used during cruise, because the aerodynamic cost of the created drag outweighs the small energy gain. However, regeneration would make more sense during descent, where windmilling props could act as a kind of regenerative brake, helping to aerodynamically slow down the aircraft while charging the batteries. That said, descent is a short phase at the end of a flight, and the recovered energy wouldn't count for much, as the batteries can simply be charged after landing at the airport. But it could make sense when landing at a remote location without charging infrastructure, or when quick turnaround times are desired. One scenario where regeneration could be truly valuable is in the event of a turbo generator failure. If the engine dies and the batteries are depleted, the aircraft could descend while windmilling the props to recharge the batteries enough to power the motors and enable blown lift for a slow, low-energy emergency landing. So, while distributed propulsion adds complexity, it also unlocks several potential advantages, from power management and drag reduction to improved control and backup power capability. Whether all of these are implemented remains to be seen. But the design clearly opens up new possibilities. Even though small, fast-spinning propellers require more power to generate the same thrust as large, slow-spinning ones, they do come with some key advantages. First, you can actually fit 8 of them along the wing to generate blown lift across most of the span, something simply not possible with 1 or 2 large props. Second, smaller propellers can spin much faster, and that's actually a good match for electric motors, which are most efficient at higher RPM. This also removes the need for a propeller speed reduction unit, which is required on turboprops to slow down the shaft for large diameter propellers. In turboprops, for example, the turbine spins far too fast for a big propeller, so a propeller speed reduction unit is essential. But with electric motors driving smaller props, no gearing is needed. That means less weight, less complexity, and lower maintenance. So while smaller props are less efficient when considered in isolation, they complement electric propulsion and enable key features like distributed thrust and blown lift. The keen-eyed may have noticed some differences between Electra's demonstrator and the artwork of the full-scale production version. This is completely normal at this stage of development, but some things I picked up are quite interesting. For example, on the demonstrator, the electric motors are mounted at different heights using staggered pylons, and the inner motors have larger propellers. In contrast, the renderings show all 8 propellers as identical in size and height. This could be something specific to the prototype, or they could just be testing various aerodynamic setups. It's likely they're testing larger, more efficient inner propellers, possibly with variable pitch blades, to improve both takeoff performance and cruise efficiency. However, there's a trade-off. Larger propellers must spin slower to avoid high tip speeds, which means their slipstream is slower and that reduces blown lift in the inboard wing sections. But this might actually be intentional. You generally want the wing root to stall before the tips to achieve good stall characteristics. By reducing blown lift near the root, the design may naturally shift stall onset inward, improving low-speed stability. Traditionally, this is done using washout, which is a gradual twist in the wing so the tips have a lower angle of incidence than the roots. But washout introduces inefficiencies in cruise, because different parts of the wing operate at different effective angles of attack in flight. If the Electra can achieve the same stable stall behavior through propeller slipstream management, it may reduce the amount of geometric washout required on the wings, enabling better cruise efficiency. Of course, this is entirely speculative and may not be practical at all, especially given the need for safe stall characteristics in an engine-out scenario. But it does highlight the intriguing possibilities and shows how deeply integrated the propulsion and aerodynamic design could potentially be. The Electra Ultra Short is showing a level of promise that few, if any, electric-only aircraft projects do. As a fixed-wing hybrid electric design, it has its feet firmly planted in reality while still offering the potential for reduced emissions and more efficient operations. Electra is targeting certification and entry into service by 2028, which isn't far off. But judging by the current pace, I could easily see the transition from demonstrator to production prototype happening by 2027, if not sooner. After that, it's testing and certification, which who knows how long that will take. The demonstrator you've seen in these clips already completed its first hybrid electric flight in November 2023. So this is very much real, not just another pipe dream. What do you think? Isn't it refreshing to finally see a practical, well-grounded project in electric aviation in a sea of overhyped electric VTOL concepts? And could the Electra Ultra Short be the aircraft that finally brings short-haul, short-field commercial flights from the 80s into the 21st century? Let me know in the comments. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one.